Hi everyone, I'm Mikel Wisler, and I sincerely believe that science fiction can help us save the world. On this episode, I get to talk to author Alec Nevala-Lee, the author of a fantastic book called Astounding, about the early days of science fiction and the golden age, as it were, and ask him if it was really the golden age. So let's dive in. This is Exploring Tomorrow. Well, thank you so much, Alec, for being on this episode. I really enjoyed reading your book, Astounding, which details the early days of the development of science fiction, and it was first published as the pulps, and the big influence of John W. Campbell, L. Ron Hubbard, Heinlein, Asimov, you know, it's all these big names that we associate with the golden age of science fiction. And it's a big book, but especially to cover all that history could seem so heady and challenging. And yet I was utterly sucked into it and just fascinated by the very human journey that these people were on and how nuanced and complex their lives were. So thank you for writing such a fascinating book. Can you tell me a little bit about how this project came about?
Sure. Thanks, number one, for having me on, and thank you for the kind words. I really appreciate that. Because I really was trying to write a book that could engage both hardcore science fiction fans, but also casual fans or even ordinary readers who didn't really have an interest in science fiction, but enjoy literary biography or just learning about this very interesting subculture. Because going in, I actually didn't know much about it. So the origins of the project come out of the fact that I kind of began as a short science fiction writer on the fiction side, and I've been writing for a magazine called Analog Science Fiction, in fact, for a long time now. I published about a dozen stories there over the past decade or so, and I love hard science fiction. I've been a fan, you know, for a long time, and my original idea was to write a book about the magazine. So I would, you know, acquire, you know, as you see behind me, a lot of back issues of Astounding and Analog, which was the name it acquired later on, and just read them all or as much as I could and just tell the story of how hard science fiction evolved in America through the lens of this one magazine, which would have been a pretty good book. I think it would have been a fun book to write. And I ended up doing a lot of that research anyway. But what I realized probably on day one of, you know, looking into this project was that there had never been a biography of John W. Campbell, who was the editor of Astounding and Analog during its most famous period. And I'm still astonished by this fact that in all the years since Campbell died, no one had written his biography, because he is a immensely complicated, interesting figure who is hugely important. You know, he almost single-handedly defined, you know, what science fiction was in America, you know, for decades. And, you know, his personal life was very interesting, and he was a flawed person in a lot of ways. But, you know, someone I, you know, immediately knew would make a fantastic subject for a big biography. And so I pitched the idea saying, you know, this guy deserves a book. And my editor, who was not a huge science fiction fan, said, you know, she liked the idea, but she wasn't sure that Campbell was familiar enough to a mainstream audience to justify this kind of project. And she said, can you make it a group biography instead? Can we bring in three or four other people to kind of flesh out the story a bit? And I said, well, you know, you look at Campbell, and the names that come to mind are Isaac Asimov, Robert A. Heinlein, and L. Ron Hubbard. Right. And she said, that sounds great. Because these are clearly famous figures. They are, you know, hugely influential and familiar in mainstream pop culture. And they were friends. They were collaborators. They hung out together. You know, they were part of this circle of people. And so the book kind of became a portrait, not just of Campbell, even though he's still the central thread in the story, but also just this community, you know, of writers and fans who really, you know, defined science fiction and modern fandom in ways that you can still see today. So, you know, the book got bigger, as you noted. It was a very complex project, but I'm really happy with how it turned out.
Yeah, as you should be. It's quite an undertaking, but I can understand that too, of like wanting to bring in some of those other figures. But I think it then rounds it out too into being this really the biography of the beginning of science fiction as we understand it today in a lot of ways. And interestingly enough, the sort of accidental or inadvertent biography of the formation of Scientology in the process there as well. How familiar were you with all those sort of various aspects of not just L. Ron Hubbard's life, but Asimov's personal life and Heinlein's personal life before diving into this?
I was familiar with it in a very casual way, in the way that I think a fan who had read some of these authors would be. I knew Campbell mostly through Asimov's memoirs. So Asimov had published this huge two-volume autobiography in the 70s that I still love. It's a great book. It's very readable, and I read it years ago. And so, you know, his picture of Campbell is as a mentor, a very important figure for him. And so I knew Campbell through that. I knew that Campbell had written the novelette Who Goes There, which was later adapted into The Thing. Right. That's probably his most familiar contribution to popular culture. And I knew about the Scientology connection because he and Hubbard had been friends, and Campbell figures in a very tangential way in most histories of Scientology. Okay, and I didn't know at that point, and no one really had talked about how central he actually was to, you know, that process. So it was, and at Heinlein, you know, I'd read some of his novels, but I had not spent a lot of time thinking about him. So I think one advantage I had going into this book is that I was a fairly, you know, I like to think objective person. I didn't have a lot of, you know, personal opinions about these people, aside from my assumption, which ended up being correct, that they were important and interesting and worth taking seriously. So the book really evolved in response to the material I found. No one had really looked at Campbell's letters in a systematic way before. And, you know, they're an amusing resource. You know, no one had really written a book where, you know, you try to tease out not just Campbell's influence on science fiction, but also his personal life. So, you know, he was a very interesting person that, you know, I again, like, is sort of suited to this kind of project. So, you know, the book ended up being, I think, objective, but also very critical. I think some people are surprised. They look at the cover and the title and they think it's a celebration of this period. And I think it is in some ways. You know, I still love hard science fiction. I love this period. I love, you know, a lot of the stuff that Campbell and these writers did. But, you know, they were all really messed up people. And this is something that I did not go in. I didn't go in knowing this. I didn't go in with an axe to grind when it came to stuff like Campbell's racism or Asimov's treatment of women. I knew Hubbard was a real character and a, you know, kind of a basket case. But, you know, and he became more complicated, you know, the more I thought about him. And so the book's attitude towards its subjects is one that kind of came organically from what I discovered in the record. And I think that shows.
Yeah, it definitely does. Yeah, because that's certainly an interesting aspect of this, that it is very nuanced. There were a lot of things that I thought, oh, this is really fascinating and cool. But also, as I've thought about how science fiction is evolving today. Actually, just recently, just had Cheryl Vint on the show, and we were talking about her new book for MIT Press around how science fiction, what it's become today, and how the diversity of voices, and how it continues to be a tool for us to make sense of this like rapidly changing technological world. But thinking about like where we are and where we come from. There's definitely, I think, some bones to pick, right? And some things that I feel, especially as a fan of a lot of science fiction from that era, and as a white male, I feel like I got to recognize where that particular American white male perspective really dominated the field in those early days, and really kind of shaped what science fiction was and wasn't in some ways. And you know, you mentioned a little bit, like, people were being like, oh, you're hoping maybe it was a celebration. What kind of other responses have you gotten from people as far as that kind of treatment of the book?
I mean, surprisingly, the response from science fiction fans has been mostly very positive, at least from older fans and even younger fans. I didn't quite know what to expect. But I think in many cases, these fans are just happy that these writers are still being talked about at all. I think Campbell especially had kind of disappeared from the conversation for a long time. And, you know, he's back in the conversation. And, you know, a lot of it is about his racism and about his, you know, I mean, there are aspects of his personality that are very repellent. But I think that's the price that had to be paid to acknowledge his importance, right? You can't talk about Campbell in the year 2021 without addressing some of these issues. But at the same time, you know, I think Campbell, who was not afraid of controversy, would be happy that he was still seen as this influential force, which I think is correct. I think you can't, you know, without him, you take him out of the picture, and the history of science fiction is very different. I don't know if it's better or worse, but it, you know, it would not be the same without Campbell. And I think he would be pleased that this fact is being acknowledged, even if it forces us to confront certain things that are less comfortable. So I think the fans, you know, have responded to that. I think there is a conversation about Campbell's influence that is ongoing. And I think we've actually barely begun. I think it's very easy to point to certain things about Campbell that are objectionable to anyone. Any reasonable person would look at Campbell and say, you know, these are things we don't support. But at the same time, there are also things that he did that are widely seen as good things, or at least as things that shaped science fiction as we know it today and have kind of, you know, come to accept it as, that are also kind of, to me at least, ambiguous in terms of their impact. Stuff like Campbell's assumptions about science and engineering, the idea that, you know, you can solve problems in certain ways, you know, via this figure that was called the competent man, who, you know, uses science in the way that a pulp hero would use a gun, or, you know, other, you know, more conventional sort of trappings of these heroes. You know, I mean, that is central to science fiction, or to a lot of science fiction. You know, this figure who solves problems through engineering is one that I think a lot of science fiction fans still believe in. And I actually think that figure needs to be questioned as well. And I think it comes a lot out of Campbell's personal beliefs and prejudices about this stuff in ways that are, you know, not entirely recognized. I think he single-handedly kind of defined what science fiction is going to be about for a long time. And those assumptions are still there. And I know that a lot of writers and fans push against them in ways that I think are important, but we haven't quite come to terms with the idea that, you know, there is something about Campbell that is essential to science fiction, and maybe it's not a good thing. Maybe it's something that needs to be questioned.
Mm-hmm. So there's room to still continue deconstructing that and doing some mm-hmm. sense making around that. I mean, I'm certainly, you know, as far as like what Campbell, I think, was trying to do, I resonate a little bit with in terms of the idea of here's this genre that can encompass so much, that can deal with this like massive breadth, really everything in existence, you know, and can hopefully be used as a means to inspire people to build a better world. I'm certainly interested in that capacity, even if ultimately I'm like, well, the ways I'd like to do that would be through exploring, you know, big philosophical questions, and not necessarily assuming always the answer is the competent man, and bringing in more diverse voices into this mix. How do you see other people beginning to or continuing to deconstruct Campbell's influence in science fiction today?
Well, I mean, it's funny because like science fiction is so huge, right? And there's so many different kinds of it that, you know, it's very, you know, it can be tricky sometimes to sort of identify and define, you know, certain trends. I will say, I guess, a couple of things. One is that there is still a Campbellian thread in science fiction that is not really questioned, that I think, maybe should be. I was thinking about this a lot recently because I reviewed Andy Weir's new book, Project Hail Mary, for the New York Times.
Just finished that one.
Yeah, maybe we can you know, talk about that a bit too, because, you know, I mean, Andy Weir, I like a lot of what he does. I think he is very good at honoring this tradition of hard science fiction that really is Campbellian. I mean, the Competent Man story, The Martian, is a quintessential Competent Man story.
Right.
Project Hail Mary is a, in many ways, the kind of story that Campbell would have loved and you know, probably would have published and Astounding in the late 30s. But, you know, Andy Weir, at least with The Martian and this new book, he defines the story in ways that exclude a lot of things that he's not good at. You know, he's very good at the science, the engineering, at sort of this problem solving that is, you know, I think a very Campbellian kind of approach to this kind of narrative. He's not very good at constructing relationships or plausible future societies. And so he sets up stories where you literally have like one guy by himself. You have one guy by himself on Mars or in a spaceship, and all he has to do is solve these problems. And whenever the story strays from that thread, when there are flashbacks or cutaways to like other people, it really kind of falls apart. That central story is pretty solid, you know, because it deliberately excludes a lot of things that hard science fiction isn't always good at talking about. Mm-hmm. And I think, that's very interesting to me. Like Weir has become a huge success because I think people respond to this kind of story. But, you know, it's very hard for me to read these books now, especially after having written Astounding, and not be very conscious of their limitations, because there are mm-hmm. things that they don't want to do or that they aren't able to do that he very cleverly avoids, you know, in his most successful work. But, it's a shortcoming. You know, I'm not saying that every story has to do the kind of, you know, thing that I'm talking about, where you engage with social issues and such. But, the hard science fiction approach to the world doesn't always provide us with interesting answers or interesting approaches to these problems. And I think, you know, that in Weir's case, you know, again, decades after Campbell, stopped being active in the field, you know, you can still see his influence there, I think.
For sure. For sure. Yeah. I mean, we brought up, you know, that construct, that rubric of the competent man, immediately Andy Weir's work comes to mind as still very much embodying, that reality. So that makes sense. Do you see other, like, what would you say is maybe someone who's, succeeding in, writing hard science fiction, but also bringing in some of these bigger social aspects?
That's a good question. I should caveat this response a bit by saying that I'm actually not as familiar as I would like to be with what's being done at this moment in science fiction. Mm-hmm. My area of expertise is, you know, stuff that was going on in, you know, 1945. I will say that to me, I can name individual authors, but the real movement here is in the genre as a whole. Mm-hmm. I think the science fiction community has been very deliberate about incorporating a wider range of voices than it has in the past. I think you see this in the Hugo Awards. You see this, you know, in the stories that get picked up and, you know, that get recommended. And I think people are aware of these issues in a way that they were not, or at least they're openly discussing these issues in a productive way, in a way they were not during Campbell's time. And, you know, it's overdue. I think that I would say this, you know, Campbell could have enabled this conversation in the 60s. You know, think about what was going on in the world during the tail end of his editorship. And, you know, these are not new problems. These are, you know, these issues of representation and diversity and institutional, you know, racism. You know, these are all things that were being discussed in 1968. And Campbell chose not to deal with them. You know, he wasn't interested. And to me, that's always been you know, I'm struck by this because Campbell loved the idea of science fiction that was about social change. And he did not make the effort to expand his demographic of authors and fans in a way that would actually incorporate voices of people who had been impacted by social change in the real world, in real time, you know. And, yeah. you know, that project, the project of trying to diversify the, you know, the number of voices you have in science fiction, that was consistent with what Campbell believed. You know, if he really believes that this is what science fiction is set up to do, and he clearly did, there is a version of Campbell that could have said, instead of, you know, like recruiting the white male engineers who I've been going after in the past, I'm going to look for people that look different than I do, who might actually have interesting perspectives, you know, on change that I don't have, that you know, aren't reflected in the magazine as it currently stands. He didn't do this. But I think editors and especially writers and fans are doing this right now. And I think the genre is obviously a lot healthier and more interesting as a result.
Yeah, I would agree. Yeah, it's been, you know, it's been something that I've grown fascinated with, being able to experience different perspectives than anything that I might have, even though I'm, my, you know, sort of multicultural in my own way, and having been born and raised in South America and Brazil, and falling in love with science fiction while young, and still very much identifying or living a Brazilian reality, but then moving to America with American parents, you know, kind of getting away from all of that, it's been really fascinating for me to step back and like really try to look intentionally for the who's doing really fascinating science fiction that's not white male, you know. Mm-hmm. And yeah. And as much as, like, you know, I read Andy Weir's new book and for the most part enjoyed it, and but that's not the only kind of science fiction that I want to exist. So I definitely relate to what you're saying about how we need to examine, I think, some of our assumptions about how science fiction can work and what even potentially counts as science fiction in some ways, because there's certainly something major to be said about deconstructing where are we as a society, where are we headed, and the choices that are being made there. And one of the things I enjoy seeing discussed in science fiction that I'd like to see more of is economics, really, and a broader understanding of that. And doesn't feel like, even though Heinlein kind of got into economics periodically in his stuff, it doesn't feel like that the Golden Age really was all that interested in diving into that. It seems to steer mostly clear of that. I don't know if he...
Yeah, I mean, a lot of this is, again, I was bringing things back to Campbell, and Campbell was not that interested in questioning capitalism. You right. know, he loved to, like, you know, set himself up as this opponent of orthodoxy. And he said, you know, I'm here to, like, question the establishment conventional view of the world, which he did in certain ways. But there are certain assumptions he did not question. I mean, there are exceptions. But for the most part, you know, he was a conservative. He was a capitalist. You know, he basically, you know, did not actively seek out stories that tried to envision alternate ways of arranging the world. And I think you do see other writers exploring these issues elsewhere, and they do come into, you know, some of the stories that Campbell published. But again, a lot of it comes down to what he felt like looking into, that he was powerful enough that he was able to, you know, kind of steer writers in certain directions and away from others.
Yeah, yeah. Which has a pretty interesting influence that he was able to exert there. And one wonders too, like what we may have, we may not even realize we've missed out on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Purely a speculation and on that front. And I love it that they, you know, so you, this came about because of your already like embedded interest in analog, which I've also read for years and really enjoy. Just a while back, had Frank Wu on talking a bit about about his story in the absence of instructions to the contrary.
Mm-hmm. It's a great story.
Yeah, yeah, and so it the idea of analog and its history is again something that's really draws me in. Do you think there are ways in which I don't know, there's like more to the history of science fiction in terms of non-hard science fiction and fantasy that a companion book might be worth doing.
Well, you're sure. You know, the only issue is like, I only have so much time.
Right.
I only have one career and these books take a long time. You know, these books take a long time to write. I mean, I would love to write a book. You know, one book I've had in mind for a long time is a book that would kind of take place on the West Coast, you know, during the same period. Because if you look at people like Ray Bradbury, who is not really a figure in Astounding, you know, clearly there's something to be told there. Lee Brackett, even people like Forrest J. Ackerman, you know, they had their own community in Los Angeles. And I don't really talk about it because they were not Campbell writers for the most part. And, you know, this book had to be constrained in certain ways. It couldn't be a history of American science fiction in, you know, in its entirety in the way that I approached it, because that would have been unpublishable. So I had to pick and choose stuff based on, does it relate back to Campbell? And so someone like Ray Bradbury, or even like Arthur C. Clarke, you know, very well-known names from that period, I couldn't really talk about except for, you know, in passing, because they were off on their own. They were doing their own thing. There weren't any great stories about them hanging out with Campbell. Even someone like A.E. Van Vogt, who I think is a really great writer, who I actually admire more than some of the people I wrote about here. He was a Campbell writer, but he never really met Campbell until much later. And so there's no, again, I wanted stories about these writers, you know, in the same room. And so there are minor writers who were in the same room as Campbell, who get much more space in this book than they maybe deserve, in terms of like a broader picture, you know, history of science fiction, just because of the narrative that I was telling.
Right.
Anyway, yes. So the short answer is that I would love to see other writers tackle similar subjects in the same way. You know, there are dozens of books about science fiction that could be written, you know, along these lines, and I really hope someone else does it.
Yeah. Actually, even as you were saying that, I can't help but think, hey, Ken Burns, can you make a big series on science fiction?
That would be awesome. Watch that. Yeah. Yeah. No, you never know. It could happen. So yeah, no, I mean, there's so much material out there. You know, there's stuff I cut out of the book that I didn't have room for.
Sure.
You know, the original draft was twice the length, you know, what I published, and it was not padded. It was just good stuff that I had to cut. So again, I'm not ruling out the possibility that I could do this again at some point, but
it's not a light task.
Right. Yeah. And currently it's not on my horizon.
Right.
So yeah, no, I would much rather see someone else do the same thing.
Yeah. Makes sense. Yeah. That's great. And you know, you mentioned, you know, the fact that there's these various communities and the book kind of touches on sort of those early days too, where there, you know, it was already kind of a divide between science fiction fandom, and it's interesting to kind of like understand that and see how that kind of influenced and shaped people like Campbell and other writers. You know, and watching, you know, you talk about how Asimov's kind of stuck in the middle of these groups and kind of like, oh, what, you know, where do I fit in all of this, as he's kind of finding his own footing. Is there something just about fandom in science fiction that even from the inception means there's a bit of like tribalism and like we kind of split off and like us versus them?
Yeah, it's funny because one thing I kind of try to point out in the book is that what we think of now as science fiction fandom, it's a tiny piece of the readership of Astounding, which in itself is a tiny piece of the science fiction market, which in itself is a tiny piece of the pulp magazine market. So we have like millions of readers, thousands of readers in, you know, the case of Astounding. And then at the center, or so they see themselves, is like a couple hundred fans. You know, these are the people that are joining and founding clubs. They're publishing mimeographed fanzines. They're the ones whose names kind of stick in the history of science fiction. And naturally, like, these people are the obsessive confrontational type. You know, there's a certain type who, you know, mostly, you know, young men who will carve a place for themselves in the history of science fiction. And there are many other fans and readers who we don't remember. But the ones we do talk about now are clearly going to be big personalities, people like Donald Wolheim and, you know, the Futurians, Sam Moskowitz. You know, these are people who yeah, as you say, you know, they were tribal. They love to create controversy. It's similar in some ways to what you see online. So, you know, many people go online without causing any kind of conflict at all. But, you know, a small number of people on Reddit or Twitter or whatever, you know, the dynamics there are the same as you see in the 30s. You know, certain kinds of fans tend to react against other fans in some other ways. And one thing that I really enjoyed seeing was these patterns, you know, that repeat themselves. And, you know, the account of sort of like some of these like fan dust ups in New York in 1939, you know, very similar to what you see online today.
Yeah.
So, you know, the behaviors haven't really changed, but they've been magnified and kind of force multiplied by the internet, by other, you know, the resources they have available these days.
Which is in itself like a living out science fiction.
right. Yeah.
That we, oh, now we have this instant communication. I can just get on my phone and angry mm-hmm. tweet someone who disagrees with me about right. my opinion of Andy Weir's new book or whatever.
Right.
No, that is fascinating. And then there's also the aspect of, I just can't help but wonder, was it inevitable in this early stage that something like Scientology would kind of springboard out of science fiction to some degree? Or is that just kind of a weird coincidence?
No, I think it's deeply entwined. And again, you take Campbell out of the picture, who knows? Maybe it'd be a little bit different. But, you know, Dianetics, which was the therapy that Campbell and Hubbard developed together, is an expression of Campbell in the same way that hard science fiction was an expression of Campbell. You know, Campbell believed in, as I said before, you know, solving problems through engineering. And he was obsessed by the idea of kind of nurturing a real discovery, you know, within the magazine that would have an impact on the real world. And, you know, you see this impulse, you know, during the war, you know, he really thinks he can contribute to the war effort by coming up with these gadgets and ideas, none of which really pan out. And then after the war, you know, he can't run the Manhattan Project. He doesn't have a lot of resources, you know, in that way. But, you know, to you know, develop a new science of the mind, you just need two people in a quiet room. And Campbell became obsessed by the idea that the way to save the world from the bomb was to develop the science of the mind that would allow us to forestall some of the human impulses that might lead to World War III. And that's where it comes from. I mean, so that impulse, you know, that line of thinking, it's very similar to the line of thinking that produced these classic stories, you know, this idea of science as a way to solve problems. And what Hubbard and Campbell said, you know, was let's apply the same approach to the brain. And we're going to come up with a system that has rules that you follow and you get this result in the same way you would, you know, in like a laboratory experiment. So Dianetics itself is absolutely an expression of science fiction under Campbell's editorship. And, you know, that to me is like one of the core points of this book is that science fiction produces, you know, the three laws of robotics, but it also produces Scientology, you know? And so that to me says that those values are at best ethically neutral and they can be turned in all kinds of directions that you can't expect.
That makes sense. I think that's that makes a lot of sense, you know, cause that's one of the things I guess I found fascinating and frustrating at the same time. Cause like on the one hand, I really appreciate the impulse of how are we going to respond to this cataclysmic creation, the atomic bomb and respond to the aftermath of World War I and II. And the idea of like, okay, well we need to address human mind. Okay. I get that. I'm aboard. But then what follows, you know, it just in spite of Campbell's stated, you know, desire to use science in these ways, what follows seems patently unscientific in so many ways mm-hmm. and based on confirmation bias, not open for peer review, and therefore not in really any significant sense scientific. And I guess that's where it's just as fascinating to me, just that the level of like how big that blind spot is mm-hmm. For Campbell.
One thing that I talk about is, and I don't say this in so many words in the book, but you know, the idea of the competent man and kind of the heroic model of narrative science fiction kind of poisoned Campbell's approach to science. You know, he was convinced that he was the main character in his life story. and that, you know, any discovery that, you know, was made, he would personally shepherd into being. And so, you know, he became obsessed by these weird ideas, like, you know, I mean, Dianetics, obviously, later psionics, psychic powers, and these like weird machines he built, you know, that kind of did weird stuff that no one could replicate. You know, and it comes out of this idea that he was going to be the one to kind of take the lead. And, you know, it was not a collaborative process. I mean, he kind of spoke of it as though it were this collaboration between him and the writers and the fans. But, you know, it was all about him in the end. You know, he wanted that recognition. He wanted that glory. And that's equally true of Hubbard, you know, probably even more so. And like, I think that impulse is the thing that kind of you can trace back and say, this is where they went wrong. You know, this idea that it has to be driven by us personally, it's very easy to take that inclination into really strange directions if it's not checked.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that speaks to the distinctly Western white male individualistic, you know, influence that is felt in science fiction, I think, at that point, because it's interesting that it is, you know, focused on the competent man, not the competent species or the competent right. community, which is yeah. in itself telling.
Yeah. No, I mean, a big theme of the book is, you know, there are certain conventions that we embrace in fiction that work because we're telling stories, right? So the competent man, the hero, you know, who solves problems. This is a great framework for a science fiction story. And Campbell certainly, Hubbard certainly, Asimov and Heinlein to a lesser extent, you know, they kind of confused that narrative model with the real world, you know, and they said, this is how my life is going to be. This is how, you know, things actually do work. And I'm not sure that's true. And I think that a lot of the tragedy of Campbell's life was his attempt to become the competent man that he had written about and had edited and published, which in practice, it comes at a cost. It can come at a huge personal cost. And I think Campbell's life really expresses that.
Yeah. Yeah. I can definitely see that for sure. Now, Alec, you also write science fiction, as you mentioned. And I'm actually like halfway through right now. I haven't got a chance to quite finish Syndromes yet, but your collection of short stories, really fantastic.
Thanks.
Enjoying it very much so far. And so how does all of this sort of this background and your own sort of vested interest in analog, how do you personally sort of wrestle with all of that in your own writing?
Well, one thing I want to kind of underline, because maybe it's not clear from what I've said before, is that I love hard science fiction. You know, I talk about its limitations, but, you know, they're kind of self-imposed. I think hard science fiction, when practiced in the highest, you know, sense, is this wonderful game. You're saying, we're going to tell these stories that are fantastic and surprising and interesting, and we're going to play by the rules. We're going to say certain things are possible. We're going to try to honor the laws of physics, you know, and of known science as much as we can. And then what can we construct within that, these constraints? And to me, that's so fun. To me, that is a wonderful game that I love playing. And you know, the stories I write, they usually come out of, you know, like an actual scientific fact or, you know, a backdrop that I find interesting. And I'm like, how can I tell a story that is unexpected, that is still accurate, or at least isn't accurate in ways that are, you know, outside the purview of analog magazine.
Right.
And so, yeah, no, I do it because I enjoy it. And, you know, someone like Andy Weir, I respect what he does in terms of saying, you know, I'm going to calculate exactly how you would do this complicated space maneuver. And I like it, you know, it's really fun. And I admire the effort that goes into it, because I've done the same thing. I'm like, how do I make the story consistent with the facts as I know them? But I also like the idea that hard science fiction, you can start from that factual basis and then kind of go into these weird emotional areas that other kinds of science fiction, you know, I'm not saying that you can't do them, but, you know, I think hard science fiction is really good at evoking scale, awe, you know, a sense of wonder, the uncanny, you know, the sense the world is different than what we actually think it is. You know, these things to me are what I try to go for, you know, and the stuff I read and to some extent in what I write. And I think hard science fiction actually gives people a set of tools that you can use to tell these kinds of stories that do have this kind of singular emotional impact that you get when you try to play by those rules.
Yeah, makes sense. Yeah. And so with the short stories you've been writing, and you've written some novels, I believe as well. What has been sort of, I guess, for you, the most rewarding aspect of getting to do that side of it, of being a creator?
I mean, there's nothing like it. I you know, I'm still delighted when I see something I've written in print. A big reason why I write for Analog is that it's one of the last print magazines available. You know, and I know that there are other online magazines that have done great work and in some ways are more visible to people. But to me, there's something like seeing us, you know, my name on the printed page. So there's that, you know, there's that satisfaction. There's the satisfaction of being part of this tradition. You know, I mean, Analog, as I know firsthand, you know, it's this 90-year-old magazine that has a huge history. And I frankly relate more to 1930s pulp writers than I do in some ways to, you know, writers of my own generation. I like seeing myself as a part of that continuity, you know, you know, the succession of writers who publish stories like this. But, you know, at the same time, trying to push it into directions that were influenced by the things that I enjoyed growing up. You know, my biggest science fiction touchstone was The X-Files. And, you know, it was because I was 12 years old or whatever, you know, when that show premiered. And it got to me in ways that nothing else has since. And so a lot of my early stories, especially, are homages to that show. And you know, a big part of the fun for me was like, how can I write an X-Files story that Analog will publish, you know, that is actually scientifically grounded. And so, you know, I like to say that, you know, in my stories, these are X-Files in which, you know, Agent Scully is actually right. You know, that there is a rational explanation. It starts out looking really weird and kind of uncanny and paranormal, but then actually, no, it's actually just a reflection of some scientific facts we haven't, you know, taken into account. So that, what I call that game, to me is by far the most satisfying thing about writing stories like this.
That's great. I was even going to ask about that because, you know, I felt that influence, particularly, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, Coataro. Yes.
Yeah.
That story, I was very much, this is an episode of The X-Files. Like, good. This is like a monster of the week episode.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, a lot of these stories had you know, exactly. That's what I'm thinking of in the back of my mind. You know, I'm trying to recreate the feeling I had watching some of those really classic episodes, you know, back in the early 90s.
Yeah. It was great. And it was, yeah, like you said, it's the twist is the science actually explains it there, which is satisfying. It's really fascinating. And yet it's bewildering and bizarre in its own way.
And you know, and the combination of emotions or reactions is one that I think only comes out of this kind of story. You know, right. It has to be, you know, to me, like the idea that it's factually based is super interesting. And fun and kind of weird in a way that I wouldn't be able to achieve if I had, you know, if I weren't operating within those rules.
Right. Yeah. And it's sort of a reminder that sometimes reality can be a little stranger than fiction.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
that's great. That's fascinating. And so those stories in Syndromes, they were originally published in Analog, I take it?
Every single one. Yeah.
Nice. Excellent. What do you have going on these days? What are you working on next?
So on the nonfiction side, my big project for the past couple of years has been a biography of a man named Buckminster Fuller, who was the architectural designer best known for geodesic structures like domes. But he was a futurist, you know, and he was probably the most famous futurist in America during his lifetime. So he died in 1983, and he was, you know, so influential and famous during his lifetime. It can be kind of hard to grasp this now because he's kind of faded from the conversation a bit, but he was a big influence on me. And, you know, he definitely had this vision of technology, this kind of transformative vision of technology that became really influential in Silicon Valley. You see it in startup culture today. So I kind of wanted to like tell his story. There hasn't really been a good biography of Fuller that covered his entire career. And, you know, and kind of tease out some of these same issues that I talk about in Astounding. You know, we have this idea, or some of us have this idea, that the best way to solve social problems is through design. And Fuller embodied that assumption. And, you know, I kind of question it now in a way that I probably did not when I was a teenager reading Fuller's work for the first time. But I still respect him. He's still a very interesting guy who, you know, is much more complicated than his sort of otherworldly persona would indicate. So, you know, in some ways, it's similar to Astounding. I take someone I admire and tear him apart, you know, in ways that I would only do if I took him seriously, and right. Hopefully can persuade other readers to do the same.
Well, it seems like that's an important process in our own development as a society, is if we take the time to, one, take these people seriously, but second, actually try to grow beyond them. And I think that has to happen through that process of questioning, because we only improve. I mean, that's a scientific process, right? We look at, well, here's where Newtonian physics stops working, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't explain these other things. Well, what's wrong with Newtonian physics? Well, let's figure that out. And, you know, and then we end up with relativity. Well, then here's where relativity breaks down. We end up with quantum physics, and now they don't mesh. So what are we going to do? So it seems like an important part of the science fiction, even conversation, is to evaluate and say, okay, these are the good things, but here's how we also kind of like miss the mark. How can we improve?
Yeah. I mean, if there's a pattern, and, you know, I'm basing this on two books, so it's not really a pattern. But, you know, one thing I've done is I've taken on subjects where previous books on, you know, about these people, they've been very fannish. All right. And I'm saying that's a bad thing. But, you know, the majority of biographies of science fiction writers that are published are by fans, which makes sense, because no one else is going to take the time it takes to write a book like this if they don't care deeply about the subject. But, you know, often they are not very critical. You know, they're kind of credulous, and you get this idealized picture of a person that, you know, I mean, at this stage in my life, I question that, you know, because no one is that perfect. No one is that visionary without there being, you know, like consequences. And same thing with Fuller. You know, most of the previous books on the subject, at least for popular readers, are incredibly idealized. You know, they kind of paint him as this benevolent grandfather figure who just went around the world doing genius things because he was a genius. And to me, that's not useful. It doesn't really lead anywhere. I want to know how he did them and why. And, you know, when you start looking at those things, you start to see, oh, you know, he actually did things for practical reasons because he had objectives that were not simply to make the world a better place. Same thing with these writers. You know, they did things to advance their own goals and to, you know, satisfy needs that don't easily fit within that picture of genius as we think about it. But, you know, to me, it's much more interesting to, you know, ask that harder second question about, you know, why and how these things were done.
Makes sense. That's great. Yeah, that sounds like a fascinating book in its own right. I'll be keeping my eyes out for that. Any projected release date at this point, or still too early?
No, currently it's slated for 1 year from today, essentially. Like, I don't know the exact date, but probably May of next year. So the book is essentially finished, but there's a lot of editorial stuff that has to happen first. So I'm, you know, thinking May of 2022, but we'll see.
Excellent. Well, I look forward to checking that out, because just that idea, you know, as a science fiction fan, there's also just the aspect of wanting to look to the future in practical ways, too. So I'll be very curious to learn from your writing in that respect as well. Any fiction you're working on as well?
I took a break from writing short fiction for the period that it took to write this Fuller biography, because it was a massive project I don't think I could have pulled off in 2.5 years without really, you know, excluding everything else until I was finished. I do have an idea for a novel that I don't want to get into too much because it's not a done deal. I still have to write a proposal and like kind of find a publisher. but it would kind of return to some of the stuff we've been talking about. It would be my first science fiction novel because I've written three novels, but they're suspense fiction. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that was kind of an interesting byway. But, you know, I would love to return to science fiction and at like a longer, you know, length. And the idea that I have would build directly on the period that I describe in Astounding on some of the stories that I liked that I think deserve more recognition. You know, and kind of following up on some clues that I uncovered about interesting directions that you could take, you know, science fiction in that haven't been explored.
Wow, that sounds great. Awesome. Yeah. Yeah. It makes sense too, to take that break to, I mean, that's, you know, any kind of biography is going to be a pretty big undertaking. So
I've done two so far. I think I'm maybe done for now because you're right. It doesn't leave a lot of room for other stuff.
That's a pretty big undertaking. That makes sense. As somebody who, I haven't written any biographies or anything like that, but I do quite a bit of documentary video work. Mm-hmm. So familiar with the digging and the interviewing and the amount of time that can be sunk into that level of just trying to uncover the history, right? Mm-hmm. So makes perfect sense. You know, one of the things that I often love to ask guests is what recommendations they have. Like, what has spoken to you recently? What's science fiction that you wish more people were reading or watching or listening to? I don't know if you have anything that comes to mind.
That's a good question. You know, I mean, I've been gradually kind of edging my way back into reading more science fiction that's being published right now because, you know, I just said, like, writing Astounding, it was, again, 2.5 years plus of work where, you know, just reading all these old stories, you know, took most of my time. And so I was kind of sidelined a bit from, you know, reading current stuff. But actually, I mean, can I recommend some older stories?
Absolutely.
You know,
Absolutely.
Okay, good. Yeah, because mm-hmm. there are writers whose work, you know, you can't take for granted anymore that people have read them. Even someone like Heinlein, you know, I mean, I think there are older science fiction fans who would be really chagrined to realize this. But, you know, like a lot of younger readers haven't read Heinlein, mm-hmm. and they have a certain idea of who he was that, you know, isn't entirely accurate because he... Again, like he was a complicated person who wrote for a long time and, you know, went through many different stages, you know, and there are probably 4 or 5 different Heinleins, you know, that you could talk about. And the one that I think has become the most canonical Heinlein, you know, this is one phase out of many. So, you know, for example, I'd never read any of Heinlein's short fiction really until I tackled this book. And, you know, there's a collection called The Past Through Tomorrow, which collects his future history stories that I loved. You know, it is so, I mean, it's so accomplished given the, you know, way in which it was written, you know, kind of under pressure for these pulps. But, you know, just a huge range of ideas and settings and tones, all of which is unified. But, you know, I mean, the Heinlein of like the late 30s, early 40s to me is, you know, someone who could do almost anything. You know, he tackled fantasy, he tackled hard science fiction with lots of, you know, great sort of engineering ideas. He could do social change stories. He could do parodies. He could do, you know, short funny stories. He could do it all. So, you know, I definitely recommend Heinlein, especially that collection to people. Mm. And I mentioned Van Vogt. A. Van Vogt is someone who is not read as much as, you know, he should be, in part because he's a weirdo. He's a very strange writer. And I think you have to kind of overcome a certain amount of period prose to get into Van Vogt. But you read some of his stuff. There's a novel called The World of Null A that I talk about a lot that, you know, without him, you wouldn't have Philip K. Dick. Mm-hmm. You know, Dick talks about Van Vogt as an influence and, you know, this sense of a incomprehensible reality that you're kind of thrust into where there may be rules, but, you know, it's unclear if even the writer understands what the rules are. You know, this kind of uncanny, disorienting fiction, to me, it gets at something very fundamental about how the world works that someone like Heinlein does not. You know, someone like Heinlein is fundamentally rational. And I think, you know, the world is not, or, you know, aspects of human life, at least, are not rational. And I think Van Vogt was maybe the best of that crop of writers at getting at that kind of somewhat disturbing realization, which, you know, maybe Campbell, you know, Campbell loved Van Vogt. It was not a Campbellian kind of point of view, where, you know, it wasn't a Campbellian perspective, because it did say that maybe there are no answers. Maybe there are things that we can't resolve through engineering and through being rational beings. So again, Van Vogt, as like a writer who I always say is like at once like the most primitive and the most advanced science fiction writer, you know, of that time, is someone I recommend pretty highly.
Yeah, oh, that's great. Yeah. Yeah. I haven't read a lot of Van Vogt, but what I have read is, I can definitely see that, because it's been very enjoyable. You know, and one of the things is like kind of going back into Astounding just a little bit, and the idea, and it was funny because I asked Professor Cheryl Vint this too when she was on, is that question of, you know, it's labeled the golden age of science fiction. And is it fair to say the golden age, I guess, still in light of maybe some of the nuances that we've discussed, and in light of, you know, because in some ways I look around and I see all these diverse voices writing and creating some really remarkable work today. And part of me feels a little like, I don't know, is that the golden age, or
right,
are we experiencing something special right now? I'd love to hear your take on that.
Yeah, no, I think to me, golden age is a temporal marker. It's a convenient, label for a period, which I use because that's the label that people have agreed on. And by people, I mean mostly white male fans who came of age during that period. You know, so one reason why we talk about these stories is that the writers who were fans and authors during that period became really famous later on, and they were kind of in a position to shape the history of science fiction retroactively. You know, so clearly the stuff you read when you were 12, or that you were writing when you were 20, you know, seems special to you in ways that, you know, the later stuff does not. So, you know, I think it's a golden age in the same sense that, you know, we talk about golden age comics. I don't think anyone would argue that those comics are superior to the ones that followed. And that, you know, a lot of them seem pretty crude. But, you know, they were important. And I do agree that this period did stuff that had not been done before that was crucial to the way science fiction evolved. And again, maybe it could have gone differently. Maybe it'd be better or worse if, you know, these things hadn't happened. But there's no way to understand kind of the main line of American science fiction without looking at what Campbell and these writers were doing.
That makes sense. Yeah. Yeah. So where can folks check out more of your work? I'd love, you know, love to encourage people to check out Syndrome, check out Astounding, and just kind of keep an eye out and connect with you. Where can people do that?
Well, so I do have a blog that has been inactive for a while, so it's nevala-lee.com. And if you go there, you will see that for a long time, I wrote many, many essays on science fiction that cover things that Astounding does not cover. So obviously, I would prefer that people just buy the book, because that's kind of my core, you know, thesis on science fiction. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's a lot of stuff that I didn't have room for. And in particular, you know, I didn't have a lot of room to talk about the stories. Mm-hmm. You know, people pointed this as like a shortcoming in the book, and I agree. You know, I think if the book had another 200 pages, I would have loved to have talked about, you know, more of these stories in depth. But, you know, there were certain constraints in publishing a book like this. So that stuff got cut. But I was able to preserve and repurpose some of that material on the blog. So if you want to read more about some of the stories, about some of these interesting byways that I explored and didn't have room to discuss, you know, I would recommend that people check that out.
Excellent. Sounds great. Thank you so much, Alec, for taking time to chat with me and kind of let me pick your brain about these things. You know, I definitely hope more people will continue to check out both Syndromes and Astounding, both highly worthwhile from my perspective. And, you know, I look forward to seeing what you do next, and maybe sometime here I'll have to have you back on, and we'll just chat about some of your fiction, if you're up for that.
I would love that. Yeah, anytime. Seriously.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much. Appreciate you doing this.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. Thank you.
And that was my conversation with Alec Nevala-Lee. And I really am enjoying Syndromes, which I, as I mentioned, I'm halfway through. And I definitely highly recommend you check out Astounding. It is a fascinating book. And, you know, you might expect a biography of people to potentially be dry, but it's anything but. It's actually so compelling and so engaging and so enlightening. It is truly a human tale and shines a lot of light onto how science fiction came about and why it is the way it is today. So I encourage you to check that out. And if you also would like to check out any of my stuff, I certainly appreciate that. That's at michaelwisler.com. And I'll pop some links for Alec's content as well below in the description. And I just encourage you to take a look at that. And also encourage you to subscribe if you're not already subscribed to the podcast. If you are an Apple Podcast or anywhere where you can rate it, give a thumbs up, anything like that, those are really huge boosts for the podcast, really helpful for me. And please recommend it to friends. That's, you know, certainly a big way in which these things spread. So if you've got really nerdy friends that also would love to learn about Alec Nevala-Lee's work and read Astounding or just check out this episode, please pass it along to them. That would mean the world to me. As I hinted in this episode, I did just finish Andy Weir's new book, Project Hail Mary. I am going to be talking about that in the next episode. So I'll be kind of unpacking my thoughts, my reactions to the book, and some of the interesting themes that came up from my perspective. And so I encourage you to come back next time and check out my thoughts on Project Hail Mary. In the meantime, please take care of yourself and each other out there. Be safe. Continue to read and listen to or even create good science fiction, and continue to ask those big questions. All right, we'll see you soon.